Bewildered as I am by this vast concourse and the magnificence around me, my beginning may be bad, my closing may be worse. I therefore crave your indulgence and your pardon in advance. Having been a farmer, you might very naturally expect me to view things from a farmer's standpoint and to tell you much about farming. But I do not propose to tell you about anything of the kind. It is the wish of my heart to say something, if I may be able, in the interest of California's history. I shall certainly ramble, more or less. Rambling was, you know, an early habit of Californians. Or rather, I should say it was a habit of some very early Californians. Some of us would not have found our way here, perhaps, had we not learned to ramble before we came. In the vast hive of modern activity, there must of necessity be many callings. They are indispensable to modern progress and civilization, which are inseparable. My intention is to slight no one, being all members, as we are, of the same family. In November or December of 1840, while still teaching school in Platte County, Missouri, I came across a Frenchman named Antoine Robidoux, who said he had been to California. Robidoux described it as one of perennial spring and boundless fertility, and laid stress on the countless thousands of wild horses and cattle. Every conceivable question that we could ask him was answered favorably. Generally, the first question which a Missourian asked about a country was whether there was any fever and ague. I remember his answer distinctly. He said there was but one man in California that had ever had a chill there, and it was a matter of so much wonderment to the people of Monterey that they went 18 miles into the country to see him shake. Nothing could have been more satisfactory on the score of health. He said that the Spanish authorities were most friendly and that the people were the most hospitable on the globe, that you could travel all over California and it would cost you nothing for horses or food. Even the Indians were friendly. His description of the country made it seem like a paradise. The result was that we appointed a corresponding secretary and a committee to report a plan of organization. A pledge was drawn up in which every signer agreed to purchase a suitable outfit and to rendezvous at Sapling Grove in what is now the state of Kansas on the 9th of the following May, armed and equipped to cross the Rocky Mountains to California. Our ignorance of the route was complete. We knew that California lay west, and that was the extent of our knowledge. Yet that party whose fortunes I followed across the plains was not only the first that went direct to California from the east. We were probably the first white people, except Boonville's party of 1833, that ever crossed the Sierra Nevada. Every year after the arrival of our party in 1841, immigrant parties came across the plains to California. So into the tranquility of Mexican life came the first immigrant train with its American restlessness, activity, and push, sowing the seeds which produced a later harvest of political unrest, conflict, and conquest. The number of Americans in California at this time was very small. When I went to California in 1841, all the foreigners, and all were foreigners except Indians and Mexicans, did not, I think, exceed 100, nor was the character of all of them prepossessing. The kindness and hospitality of the native Californians, however, cannot be overstated. Up to the time the Mexican regime ceased in California, they had a custom of never charging for anything. Oh, that is to say, for entertainment, food, or use of horses, etc. You were supposed, even if invited to visit a friend, to bring your blankets with you. And one would be very thoughtless if he traveled and did not take a knife with him to cut his meat. For food, we had in those days chiefly beef, game, butter, and fish. Salmon came from the ocean up the streams. When the streams had gone down, the salmon would remain in the deeper places, which were not more than 3 or 4 feet deep, often less. They were caught by taking a cord, making a noose at one end, putting it carefully over the salmon's tail, and jerking him out. We sent Indians to the sandy places, and they brought strawberries by the bushel. When the time came, we picked and dried huckleberries. From the Russian orchard at Fort Ross, apples and peaches were dried and cider made. And through the favor of Captain Richardson, captain of Yerba Buena, or San Francisco, I was able to get occasionally a little of the luxury known as brown sugar. The missions in California invariably had gardens with grapes, olives, figs, pomegranates, pears, and apples, but the ranches scarcely ever had any fruit. When you wanted a horse to ride, you would take it to the next ranch. It might be 20, 30, or 50 miles, and turn it out there, and sometime or other, in reclaiming his stock, the owner would get it back. In this way, you might travel from one end of California to the other. The ranch life was not confined to the country. It prevailed in the towns, too. There was not a hotel in San Francisco or Monterey or anywhere in California till 1846, when the Americans took the country. The first employment I had in California was in John Sutter's service, about 2 months after our arrival. He engaged me in January 1842 to go to Bodega in Fort Ross and stay there until he could finish removing the property which he had bought from the Russians. Nearly everybody who came to California made it a point to reach Sutter's fort. Sutter was one of the most liberal and hospitable of men. Everybody was welcome. One man or 100, it was all the same. He was also a man of peculiar traits. His necessities compelled him to take all he could buy, and he paid all he could pay, but he failed to keep up with his payments. And so he soon found himself immensely, almost hopelessly, in debt. Yet Sutter did much with small means. No other man, I have often thought, could have done so much in so short a time and with so little to do it with. His fine address won the esteem of all. Strangers became at once his friends. The departmental government promised him a grant of land and permitted him to take immediate possession. Individuals trusted him for large numbers of cattle and horses and for implements and goods of various kinds. The Russians sold him all their possessions and property at Fort Ross and Bodega, amounting in round numbers to $100,000, and all these on his simple promise to pay. He made his promises in good faith, and no man ever tried harder to pay, but he was seldom able to meet them at maturity. Referring to the great gold discovery, who but Sutter would have ransacked the then wild Sierra Nevada mountains to find a sawmill site? It seemed at the time an accident. I doubt if there was another man in the United States who would have undertaken in 1847 to build a sawmill in a canyon in the Sierra Nevada mountains 50 miles from Sacramento. No sugar pine lumber had ever been seen except a little Sutter had milled by hand. There was little demand for lumber of any kind, for houses were generally made of adobe. Sutter was not looking for gold, but found it. As a miner might be looking for gold and find a diamond. The sawmill paid Sutter nothing, but it benefited our whole country and all countries. Well, this discovery gave impetus to trade, commerce, immigration, and almost everything else throughout the world, and was brought about by two men of most peculiar characteristics. Sutter, so confident as to believe Marshall's report of the feasibility of making a sawmill where I felt sure no sane man would advise in the light of a profitable lumber enterprise. And Marshall, so wild and erratic in judgment about such matters as to select a site most difficult, impractical, and unprofitable. Yet the two together, by this means, turned the world upside down. Of course, I believe the matter was providential. It seems almost a mockery to starve the noble pioneer to death and to starve his broken-hearted wife to death also, and then immediately proceed to do grand things to perpetuate his memory. The state of California can never atone for the ingratitude of withdrawing the pittance of aid once extended to him. No pioneer ever did so much for this state as Sutter. Nay, I verily believe no pioneer ever did so much for the United States. He suffered every hardship, privation, and danger incident to pioneer life. At last, his labors were crowned with success, but not success for himself. In 1843, Peter Lassen, whose name now attaches to Lassen Peak and Lassen County, happened at Sutter's Fort in search of a place to locate a ranch. He joined me, and we traveled up the valley for that purpose. Peter Lassen was a very singular man, very fond of pioneering, in fact, stubbornly so. He had great confidence in his powers as a woodsman, but strangely enough, he always got lost. As we passed the Butte Mountains, our route lay between the Sacramento and Feather Rivers. The point we wished to reach that night was Sutter's Hawk Farm on the Feather River. Night had overtaken us when we were some 15 miles from it. Lassen persisted in keeping the lead. Our Indian vaquero, however, who knew the country well in that vicinity, pointed to the eastward as the way we should go. Lassen could not be persuaded to go to the east, and finally, about morning, we concluded to say we must go east, and if he would not, we would leave him. This had no effect on Peter, so he kept on toward the south while we, following the Indian, came to the farm. The only place Lassen could reach being the intervening Tule Marsh. Now, if you want to see the humor a man is in after spending a night in a Tule Marsh full of mosquitoes, you ought to have seen Peter Lassen when he came to the camp at the Hawk Farm the next morning. He was so mad he would not speak to any of us all day, and I think never forgot nor forgave us. Yet he was a man who had many good qualities. He was a good cook in camp and would do everything and anything necessary in the camp, even to making the coffee, providing those traveling with him would attempt to assist him. If they did not, they at once became the target of the best style of grumbling that any man born in Denmark is capable of. But of course, each one would attempt to assist, and that was all that was necessary to do, for Lassen would drive them away and do it all himself, even to the staking of the tent. Hastening up the valley, we struck the trail of the Oregon Company on what is now known as Chico Creek. To me, it was one of the loveliest of places. The plains were covered with scattered groves of spreading oaks. There were wild grasses and clover, 2, 3, and 4 feet high, and most luxuriant. The fertility of the soil was beyond question, and the waters of Chico Creek were clear, cold, and sparkling. The mountains were lovely and flower-covered, a beautiful scene. In a word, this search was the means of locating me for life. I never was permanently located till I afterward located here. It was early in March 1843 when we reached Chico Creek. It is not easy to conceive and understand the change in the condition of the country caused by extensive pasture of horses and cattle on these plains. We seldom or never were out of sight of game, deer, elk, antelope, and grizzly bear. The snow-capped mountains on each side of the valley seen through the clear atmosphere of spring, the plains brilliant with flowers, the luxuriant herbage, all truly combined to lend enchantment to the view. Remember, when I was a boy, I used to dream that I would like to be president of the United States. Yet by the time I had grown up, I was entirely cured. I wanted to be governor of this state because people wanted me, but the railroad with its corruption and money defeated me. After one turn in Congress, I began to see the shallowness of such idealistic foreign ambitions. In 1776, our fathers made proclamation of the birth of the nation. Now, having grown to be one of the greatest powers of the earth, the freest and best government, as we believe, ever devised since the dawn of time, and become the hope of the world, this grandest governmental fabric of human invention, our beloved American nation, is, in the minds of millions of the most thoughtful and intelligent people, drifting unmistakably toward decay, if not sure and swift destruction. There are well-founded apprehensions that this nation which we love, this mighty empire of sovereign states, cannot survive unless redeemed from the dangers that jeopardize its existence, prominent among which are the numerous forms and phases of monopolistic combinations creating immense wealth in the hands of the few and impoverishing the many. The same causes and processes which have created increasing numbers of millionaires will, if unchecked under the rule of the old political parties, in time turn over the entire nation into the hands of an aristocracy of monster billionaires. If combinations may be formed ad libitum to accumulate and hoard the money and the wealth of the country, they will soon have it in their power to block the very wheels of progress, to exercise dangerous control over legislatures, courts, and Congress, if not virtually to dictate all the affairs of the nation. It is well known that railways and their natural affiliations, the great moneyed and other corporate powers, have already a most dangerous influence in all elections and in every department of the government. They are absolutely corrupting. We boast that ours is the freest and best government, and so it is. And the strongest, too, as we believe, because more than any other, it derives its just powers from the consent of the people. But the question comes home to every thoughtful mind. Is it safe for the people to surrender their rights into the hands of great corporations which are always grasping for more wealth and greater power? At an earlier period, it was the opinion of wise statesmen that the United States could not long endure half slave and half free. May we not seriously ask ourselves, can the nation now long survive with its immense wealth gone into the grasping hands of trusts and combines, and the great majority of the people reduced to poverty and a state of vassalage to monopolistic greed and soulless corporate power.